Hello, and welcome once again to Home Bible Study. From my home to your home, this is Robert Holler, thanking you for taking the time to observe this video. And always to those that subscribe, view, comment, and respond. Today's topic, the biblical hypocrisy of a blasphemer. Now, this subject is in Scripture, but it's not a subject that I've ever been around any Bible study, any church gathering, or anything, even on social media that I'm aware of, that people have taught on or looked at. And the reason I look at it, the word blasphemer, and put in the word hypocritical from a biblical standpoint is because of the word hypocrisy is being thrown around today as much as a raindrop in the spring or a snowflake in the winter. And it is not only rampant in our country, but all over the world. Now, we need to look, first of all, at the word blasphemer, or blasphemist, or blasphemer, or blasphemy in Scripture to understand what it really is. Now, there's three different words that apply to it as a singular, plural, or defining one as a blasphemer. The three are a blasphemous, B-L-A-S-H-P-H-E-R-M-O-S, a blasphemoria, B-L-A-S-H-P-H-E-M-I-A, a blasphemoeo, B-L-A-S-P-H-E-M-E-O. All three fall into the category of meanings that it's a railing, it's evil being spoken of to either God or man. That's what a blasphemer is. And it's very interesting because it shows up in Scripture quite often. And it was used in Scripture as such a hypocritical label, if you will, in the times past, especially on Jesus Christ's earthly ministry in the gospel of the kingdom under the law before the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. But you can trace this back to the Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, or the fall of mankind. And it's been with us ever since. The day sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed on to all men, for all have sinned. That's Romans 12, 5. But we're going to look at it mainly from the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ, as his time on this earth when he was part of the gospel of the kingdom message that he brought with him, and it was to the nation of Israel. Now, I'm giving you something that is predominantly for the nation of Israel. It is also for the body of Christ Church, but it is not to the body of Christ Church, and we have to get that basic understanding of the foundation that is laid, which is Jesus Christ, and we take heed of how we build on it. Because modern Christianity and religions of mankind tell you it's for you and to you also. The body of Christ Church tells you something different if you study the Word of God the way God commands you to do it, which is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And when we rightly divide the word of truth, we look at the three divisions of the cross created that we can find in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 7, 11, and 13, where you have the ages to come, the but now, and the times past. You have all three of them. And this is what's created, what Jesus Christ created when he finished the work of the cross and introduced the body of Christ Church, or the revelation of the mystery of Jesus Christ that he gave to Paul in the dispensation of the grace of God that we live in today, where we are saved by grace through faith only. But this study is for us as an example. You see, the times past of the cross was all for us as an example. Now, not as a pattern, but as an example, as a warning, if you will, as what the nation of Israel did, how they behaved with God and how God reacted to their behavior and how he punished them and drug them through all kinds of hardships, and they kept falling and coming back, falling and coming back. This is an example for us today. So we need to know about it. That's why it should be part of a study. The hypocrisy of blasphemy or blasphemy in Scripture is quite obvious, but you're going to see it from an angle that probably you never gave it much thought. Because there is a place in Scripture that Jesus Christ told his followers, the nation of Israel, his Jews, his chosen people, that he came down to minister to, because he is a minister unto the Jews, not unto the Gentiles. Never was and never will be. That is Paul's job. But in his teachings, he did say a reference about something where the word blasphemy or blasphemer came about. But before I give you that scripture, I'm going to show you in Scripture where the nation of Israel is given to us as an example to learn from, not a pattern for our doctrine. Huge difference. The difference is salvation, ladies and gentlemen. But if you open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians, and I believe it's found in chapter 10, where he's talking about the story of how Israel was baptized under the clouds unto Moses, but yet they did a lot of idolatry, and they committed a lot of sin. And I just have to find the verse here. If just give me a second, now check it out. And I suggest that you read the chapter, but you're going to find out in verse 6 is where he's going to say something that proves the point from Scripture now in the words of Jesus Christ through Paul in the revelation of the mystery that Israel was an example for us. Verse 6 in chapter 10 of 1 Corinthians says, "Now these things were our examples, to the intent we should not lust after evil things, as they also lusted." So the behavior of the nation of Israel has always been an example for us only, not doctrinal pattern. Huge difference. Now, Jesus Christ, during his earthly ministry, was accused of being a blasphemer. He was accused of saying blasphemy things. But he also said something about it when he was teaching his nation of Israel, and you find this in Matthew chapter 12, about blaspheming against the Holy Spirit. Now, modern Christianity will teach you that there is an unforgivable sin that you can be damned forever by. Now, you have to remember, when you rightly divide the word of truth, and if Israel is an example for us, that is all this unforgivable sin, as Christianity calls it, is for us to know about. It does not apply to you and me that are saved by the gospel of Jesus Christ according to grace through faith, see, and the Spirit of Jesus Christ. This does not apply to us because we do not blaspheme the Holy Spirit or rail against him or speak evil of him. But this is what Jesus Christ told his nation of Israel in Matthew chapter 12, starting in verse 31. He says, "Wherefore I say unto you, all manners of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit," or the Holy Ghost here, "shall not be forgiven unto men." Verse 32, "And whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come." Pretty powerful words. But Christianity puts a lot of guilt on people, and they will tell you, you could be guilty of this sin, see, which is a big hypocrisy of Christianity in itself. Now, continuing on, Jesus Christ in his earthly ministry said things that upset the religious leaders of his time, the Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes of the Jewish religion, who were the religious leaders of the sect of the Jews' religion, and they were members of the hierarchy of religion called the Sanhedrin. Now, they were having a discussion with Jesus, and they said that they had the word of Moses to go by. They didn't need to listen to Jesus Christ, because they didn't believe Jesus Christ said who he was, who he was. They didn't believe him. And then they said, well, we have the word of Moses. And then this is what Jesus told them. And they just got all upset because Jesus told them, he said, and we're going to start in verse 54 of John chapter 8. In 54, Jesus said, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Verse 55, yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I would be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Verse 56, your father, Abraham, rejoiced to see my day. This is Jesus Christ talking. And he saw me, he saw it and was glad. Verse 37, then said the Jews unto him, thou art yet 50 years old. Hast thou seen Abraham, which was several thousand years ago? Verse 58, and Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Now verse 59, they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and then passed by. They were ready to kill him on the spot. They were claiming blasphemies. And then they took him to trial. And they had people bear false witness to be hypocrites, to accuse Jesus Christ of being a blasphemer because he said he was the Son of God. And that was the straw that broke the camel's back, for lack of a better cliche, ladies and gentlemen, where they rendered their clothes, they threw dust in the air, away with him, crucify him, crucify him. We need no more witnessing for what we've just heard when Jesus Christ said that. Now, here's the hypocrisy of blasphemy in Scripture when you really look at it. These Jews, these religious leaders, who Jesus Christ over and over in Scripture, when he was on his earthly ministry, denounced the Pharisees, calling them hypocrites over and over and over again. And you can find this in Scripture. It's very powerful. He called them all kinds of things. He called them liars, hypocrites, vipers. But the main thing was a hypocrite, because they would tell their Jewish followers to do things and to go by the book, so to speak, the law. Yet they would do things they deemed what they wanted to do. You see a lot of that today, don't you, ladies and gentlemen? You see that within your own government, within these United States. But getting back to the biblical stance of this study, the ironic thing is the Jews that blamed Jesus Christ as being a blasphemer against God, railing against God, speaking evil against God, were the ones that actually were and are guilty of blaspheming against God. I don't know if people realize that when they look at this. Have you ever been taught this? Have you ever thought about this? That a lot of times when people accuse other people of things that they think are obvious, they're usually the things that are obvious within their own lives that's going on behind closed doors. And this was the case with the Jewish religious leaders. Now, you have to remember, these were Jewish religious leaders. They were the top echelon of the Jews' religion, held in very high esteem of men. And you remember when Jesus Christ told them, you are of your father, the devil. You're liars. You're just like your father, the devil. And they took that as being very hypocritical and blasphemy against them. And then you look at what Jesus talked about, the unforgivable sin, as people call it. It's just unforgivable to being blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. That is what the Jews, these religious leaders, are really guilty of. They can blaspheme against Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ said, if you blaspheme against the Son of Man, that will be forgiven you. But they didn't blaspheme against Jesus Christ that was the cause of their eternal damnation. They blasphemed against the very God that sent Jesus Christ, the very God that they thought they were serving, the very God in their minds, in their finite minds and finite wisdom. Through their religion, they rationalized to fit what it is they wanted to believe in their fleshly minds was okay, not realizing what they were doing. That's why Jesus Christ could tell them at the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But you know from the words of Jesus Christ, these people will never be forgiven. The Jews that sentenced Jesus Christ to be crucified, oh, they didn't drive the nails, they didn't make the cross, they didn't hang him on the tree. But they were the reason Jesus Christ went to the cross anyway. Because they are guilty of being blasphemers, yet look at the hypocrisy that they had in order to be that way, to blame Jesus Christ of something Jesus Christ was innocent of. The Pharisees, scribes, and Sadducees were fully guilty of blaspheming 100%. And they didn't realize it. They wanted the glory of men. They wanted the glory to appease the nation of Israel, the Jews, because they were the leaders of the religious sect. They wanted to get along with the Romans, and they wanted the Romans' empire to do the dirty work for them. In the reality of things, they were the ones, ladies and gentlemen, that should have hung on the cross and be guilty of blasphemy, which was a sentence of death by the Jews' religion in that time. They should have been put to death, not for redemption of mankind and his sin, but for the hypocrisy of the blasphemies that they were absolutely guilty of. And yet you look at it, and it's not studied, it's not understood. It is for us as an example. Like I said, it is not our doctrine. The doctrine for the body of Christ Church is Romans through Philemon. It is a revelation of the mystery of Jesus Christ, where Paul, the apostle, is our pattern. He's not our example, he's our pattern. The nation of Israel here is strictly an example for us. And when you have an example is there to teach you, to help you learn about something. A pattern is something you do in exact replica of what it is that's presented to you. That's the big difference between a pattern and an example. Because an example can be used for many different aspects, where a pattern can only be used for the thing that it was designed for in the first place. I did a whole video years ago on my YouTube ministry here about patterns and examples. So if the Jesus Christ of Scripture now, when he was on his earthly ministry, he not only was an example for us, but he was a pattern for us, because he is still the same Jesus Christ, you see. But what he taught the nation of Israel was an example for us only. And that is a hypocrisy that has followed the blaspheming of the Jews, religious leaders of his day, that follow into the realm of Christianity today. Because Christianity doesn't realize the blasphemies that they're doing against the very word of Jesus Christ of Scripture, you see. They think they're serving the Jesus Christ of Scripture by promoting the teachings of Jesus Christ on his earthly ministries, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the book of Acts, Romans through Philemon, Hebrews through Revelation. Let's teach it all, and let's mix it all together. If they mix it all together, then Christianity cannot get away from mixing law and grace. That is their basic foundation of their doctrine, because it is formed and founded by Satan, who has transformed himself into an angel of light, who is the greatest blasphemer that ever existed. Christianity really, in itself, has fallen from grace. It has never been a part of grace. So if it can't be a part of grace, it can never give you the basic foundation which was laid in Jesus Christ, which Paul, who is the master builder of this, built. And he warns us to take heed how we build on it. That's in Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 11, I believe. Christianity doesn't take heed on how they build. They just build on it, whatever they want. Just like the Jews, the Pharisees, scribes, and Sadducees, who were the biggest hypocrites and the greatest blasphemers during the time of Jesus Christ's earthly ministry. As to where Christianity and its leaders and its churches and its Christians are the biggest blasphemers of the modern day. Now, because Christianity teaches you that you should do everything that's in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and everything that's in the books of Romans through Philemon, and the books of Hebrews through Revelation. When you read them and you look at how they're presented and what is written, and if you believe what it is you read, it's impossible to do. That they will rationalize it because they have to come up with some way to justify their doctrine that they teach their Christians in the religion of Christianity. Christianity is guilty as blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. Even as Israel's religious leaders back in the time of Jesus Christ's earthly ministry of the gospel of the kingdom were guilty of it, they are today guilty of it because they're not members of the body of Christ church. You see, because if you blaspheme, how do you blaspheme against the Holy Spirit today? Well, you deny the finished work of the cross. You deny fully that your salvation is totally by faith, by grace through faith. No works, nothing. Everything is of the Spirit because you acknowledge the Holy Ghost. You don't rail against him. You don't mix the law in with him because Jesus Christ separated that. Jesus Christ fulfilled the law. He abolished the law. He took the curse of the law out of the way, nailing it to his cross because it was contrary to us. The ordinances were against us. All it would do is convict us of sin. And the Bible says, in the revelation of the mystery of Jesus Christ, which is the doctrine for the body of Christ, there is none that is justified by the law. And Paul teaches this over and over. There's no confidence in the flesh. The Jews had confidence in the flesh because they were part of the law. Christianity has as much confidence in the flesh as they claim to have in the spirit. And they will tell you, of course, it's all of the spirit. But when you look at it, why are they teaching the doctrine for the gospel of the kingdom, which is under the law, which has so many different aspects for its salvation message compared to the gospel of the grace of God and the dispensation of the grace of God, the finished work of the cross of Jesus Christ in the revelation of the mystery of Jesus Christ, which is a doctrine for the body of Christ church from Romans through Philemon, makes it so simple. We are given this liberty in Christ Jesus where he has set us free, never to be under the yoke of bondage again. Christianity has you under this yoke of bondage, as I've said prior. And if you're under the yoke of bondage, you are blaspheming the Holy Ghost because you don't believe the finished work of the cross. See, you don't believe that Jesus Christ is the Holy Spirit again as he was and always is. He was just in the form of a man for a little while because we do not know Jesus Christ after the flesh anymore. And that's prevalent. That is scriptural. And you can find that in, I believe it is 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's go there and let's just read that verse. I haven't read that one in a video for a long time. But 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And this is what it says. If you get into chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians, and I'll start in verse 14, verse 14 says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then all were dead." Verse 15, "And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again." Now here's verse 16. "Wherefore, henceforth," in other words, from here on out, "know we no man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now, henceforth, from here on out, know we him no more. Do you believe it is what it is you read when you read God's word? You want to be under this yoke of bondage? You want to be the hypocrite of the blasphemy that is of Scripture put on you? Your religion of Christianity has it down to a finer art than the scribes, Pharisees, and Sadducees of Jesus Christ's earthly ministry had. Because they had somebody there showing, pointing his finger in their face, calling them hypocrites, blasphemers, and of their father, the devil. See, you don't have that today. You have the word of God, of course. You have the Jesus Christ of Scripture that's telling you Israel is an example for us. And it says in there some very bad things Israel had gone through and some of the damnation waiting for a lot of the nation of Israel coming in the final judgment, ladies and gentlemen. For not all of Israel is Israel. It was Paul's prayer that all of Israel be saved, but that's not going to happen because they chose to be in unbelief of the word of God, see. Although they think they were serving their God, just like Christianity, just like your Christians today, they believe they're serving their Jesus Christ of Christianity, which they also think is the Jesus Christ of Scripture, because their Jesus Christ of Christianity tells them to believe that. They don't realize it's their angel of light. He's transformed himself into the angel of light, who is Satan, and he is using his ministers of righteousness as he manifests them to you as to spread this blasphemy of the Holy Ghost to you today. What a subtle way that you'll never see. Maybe you're too busy to bother with looking it up. You're maybe too busy to just take time, or you're just not that interested. You're just going to rely on mankind to tell you the truth of the Word of God and take it as he gives it to you. And you have to remember, those of Christianity, those that are Christians that are telling you that what the Word of God means, according to their Christianity and the Jesus Christ of Christianity, are ministers of righteousness under Satan, who has transformed himself into the angel of light for you. And you have to remember, if Israel was an example for us, the angel of light is telling you Israel is a pattern for you. And if you fall into this trap, this great lie that looks so good on the surface when people look at Christianity and look at people as Christians, they try to make this persona to the world that they're different, that they're loving, kind, giving people, accepting people, and very tolerant people because they have a higher power. Well, they have a higher power, all right. They have their god of a small g called Satan. But see how clever he is. It's never been exposed, has it? Have you ever had a chance to sit down and listen to a video or read the scriptures that I gave you and look them up and make up your own mind? Don't rely on mankind. Don't rely on me. God forbid that you would do that. And I never ask anyone to. You rely on Jesus Christ. But you better be relying on the right Jesus Christ of Scripture. Because Jesus Christ said to his followers in the nation of Israel, who is our example for us in the body of Christ Church, that many antichrists have come and will become. But you see, Satan is so clever. There's a great difference between an antichrist and Satan and an antichrist in the beast of the book of Revelation. We've done these studies multiple times. Okay? Not to get them confused. Satan is the one that can transform himself into an angel of light. An antichrist can't. So Satan is not an antichrist. And the beast of the book of Revelation doesn't have that ability to change himself into an angel of light. And he's not an antichrist because he lets you know up front. He portrays himself as the Christ. An antichrist is somebody everybody knows is against Jesus Christ. Big difference. But getting back to the study, getting back to the hypocrisies of the blasphemers of Scripture that you've seen and you heard about, and what they did they were more guilty of blasphemy of the Holy Ghost than Jesus Christ was of anything. Jesus Christ was innocent of all this. Yet he was accused of all those things that were the blaspheming of the religious leaders of his day. And you know, another ironic thing is Jesus Christ was sent to this earth to die on a cross for the sins of these people. However, when they claimed that Jesus Christ was not who he said he was, that he was an imposter, that he was a blasphemer, they were actually blaspheming God. They were blaspheming the Holy Ghost, and they did not know it. Why do you think Jesus Christ tried to warn them? You hypocrites, you blasphemers, you liars, you vipers. All sins will be forgiven, even if you blaspheme against the Jesus Christ, who I'm standing here as the Son of Man. You will be forgiven. But if you blaspheme against the Holy Ghost, it will never be forgiven, not in this world, nor the one to come. They didn't see it. They didn't understand it. They were so, and this is a true saying, they were so hell-bound of condemning Jesus Christ. You know what they did in actuality? They condemned themselves before the living God. Did you ever realize that? And that's what Christians do today. When they stand for Christianity, and they stand for the Jesus Christ of Christianity, who claims to be the Jesus Christ of Scripture, by the way. They talk about God judging. It's not going to be hard for Jesus Christ to judge those people. They are making the case for themselves right now. And the saddest thing is, their cases will be shown to them when they stand before the great white throne judgment, after they spent so much time in hell, getting ready for the lake of fire for eternity and eternal suffering, where awaiting them are going to be Satan and his fallen angels, the beast, the false prophet, and all that have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God and never came to the saving grace that God poured out on his cross, that Jesus Christ poured out and gave his life for. That all you have to do is believe by faith and faith alone to have eternal life. Because that is a pattern for us. You want to be a pattern of Jesus Christ's earthly ministry? And listen to your Christianity and your Jesus Christ of Christianity, who is really Satan, transformed into the minister of into the angel of light, who has all these ministers of his righteousness in your churches today, in your religions, in your denominations, your non-denominations, teaching you a false message. But you won't ever get away from it, will you? Because you want to appease man. If you appease man, you'll end up in hell, because you cannot serve Jesus Christ. You can be free from this yoke of bondage that Christianity has you under. Don't take my word for it. Look it up. There's a gospel that can save you from Jesus Christ. Revelation of the mystery of himself. The doctrine for the body of Christ, which is Paul given to us, and Paul is our pattern to follow Paul as he followed Jesus Christ for salvation by grace through faith. That's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4. He says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand. Verse 2, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory that what was preached unto you, unless you believed in vain. Verse 3, for I delivered first of all unto you that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And verse 4, and that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Now you believe that by faith and faith alone, because no one is justified by the law. Justification comes through faith, and it is by grace." Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Verse 8 says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, yet not of yourselves. It's a gift of God." And verse 9, "Not of works, lest any man should boast." Works were of the nation of Israel. Works were under the law. That was an example for us. It didn't work. So if it didn't work for the nation of Israel, for the majority of the nation of Israel, I should say, why do you want to follow it? Hoping it's going to work for you? and you don't realize. You might lash out at somebody like me, calling me a blasphemer, calling me a hypocrite, calling me a false teacher, a heretic, whatever you want to come up with. Caution when you do that. You may be all of those wrapped into one, and you haven't a clue that you're condemning your very own self. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Appreciate you listening. This is a home Bible study. From my home to your home, this is Robert Haller thanking you. And always remember, before the next time, you make sure Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior.